because this is Inauguration Day. Like the big day. The day that we've all been waiting for, you know, the day that many of us have spent 2 years of our lives in order to make happen. That kind of Inauguration Day. That camera's a little behind. Welcome aboard. Yes, it's here. It's finally here. We've got death threats. We've got people burning flags in the street, chanting 2, 4, 6, 8, America was never great, in the country that was great enough to give them the right to say it. Unlike all the communist hellholes that would cut their head off or jail them forever if they were to say it there. But let's face it, you really can't expect leftists to get it. When your average leftist gets their say in something, then it's fine. And everybody's supposed to drop everything that they're doing to capitulate to them, even though they're wrong. And yet, when those of us who are right actually win, then those who are right are supposed to give the same airtime, according to the fairness doctrine, as those who are wrong. Why would you give an idea that is wrong the same amount of time that you would give an idea that is right, if not only are you right, but you fairly won? And this matters because we're hearing, we're going to get into a lot of the death threats that are coming. We're going to get into all of it. Do many of you know, I was going to give this the dumbdee of the day, but I found the story after I had already set the show queue up, so we'll just talk about it. Do you know that the racist, I mean the terrible racist, evil Trump supporters out there, Paul Joseph Watson, racist Trump marchers, racist Trump supporters, excuse me, raised $650,000 to have a black marching band play at the inauguration. And there they are right there on Fact Cam. I'm going to go ahead and screen share this so that you guys on the low def can see it. High def, you're up top there. After rapper Snoop Dogg, who will be making an appearance on the Dump Cap of the Month show, promised to roast any African-Americans who performed at Donald Trump's inauguration, racist Trump supporters raised $650,000, it's so much money I can't even say it, to have predominantly black marching band play at tomorrow's event, which would now of course be today's event. Billy Hawkins, president of Talladega College, a historically black campus in Alabama, appeared on Bill O'Reilly's Fox News show to complain about mean-spirited criticism and nasty emails received after the college's famed Marching Tornadoes band tried to raise $75,000 to fund their trip to perform at the inaugurational parade. After the GoFundMe account was set up to support the band, Trump supporters donated a whopping $650,000, which at one point was coming in at a rate of $1,000 an hour. And it said, we owe Bill O'Reilly a great thank you. But wait, as Paul Joseph Watson said, aren't we all racist because we voted for Trump? And I talk about this. For those of you that don't know, I'm in the band Passing Time. I'm also a writer for the Conservative Daily Post and the Blasting News. Let me tell you something real quick. Going after somebody's legal status is not the same as going after their race. So you can all get rid of your little crybaby panderings about Trump supporters being like Hitler, or Trump being like Hitler. Hitler released Mein Kampf, which means My Struggle, which is almost the name of Obama's book. And in it, he talks about hating Jews and wanting to do terrible things to prostitutes, etc., etc. He was racist before he got in office. You can tell by his book. Trump's book, on the other hand, is about deal making. So don't give me this BS about them being racist. They simply want to know the legal status of people in the country, regardless of their color. Because it doesn't do you much good to get bombed by a white dude either. Michael Rosoff abolished the CIA. Every American who looks at the CIA objectively and in a balanced way and judges it by any number of criteria, such as moral, legal, and pragmatic, should reach the conclusion that the CIA should be abolished. JFK wanted to break it into a million pieces. Trump is right to dismiss his intelligence reports about DNC hacking. The CIA war on Trump shows us immediately that the CIA is a rogue organization within the U.S. government and a severe threat to America. Let's think about that for a second. How many times has the CIA steered presidents in a direction that many have alluded to as actually an extension of the shadow government? How many papers have come out that have made us wonder whether or not the CIA had more than likely a hand in the death of John F. Kennedy Jr. JFK. So, I mean, not Jr., JFK. So, what happens here on Teleprompter Free Radio? What happens if by some miracle the CIA was this needed asset in one instance and we didn't have them? I would venture to guess that maybe there would still be less people dying than the innocent people dying than the innocents that die with them being here. The CIA is an eternal threat to the rule of law and the government that it is supposedly serving. Senator Schumer acknowledges the CIA's unbridled power, its subversive power, its power to undermine even a president, especially one that wishes to control and alter the organization. When he says, "Let me tell you, you take on the intelligence community, you have 6 waves from Sunday at them getting back at you." For a practical, supposedly hard-nosed businessman, he's being really dumb to this. In other words, bow, Trump, bow, or we might blow your head off in the back of a limousine. Schumer is saying that the CIA is so powerful that a president should not attempt to control it or else. The CIA is so powerful, it goes on, that elections do not matter when it comes to the CIA. They stand alone. The Constitution that empowers the president as the executive, the boss of the government operations, does not matter. Basic American institution and laws must bow before the threats that the CIA poses. This is the assessment of a number of senators, beginning with the fourth term and who is the highest ranking Democrat in the Senate in his post as a primary leader. It undermines traditional America and moral values. It consistently kills innocent people. It causes instability in wars. It undermines other societies and their own. It interferes, it says, constantly in foreign affairs and is a deterrent to them and us. Detriment. And if an unelected power that challenges elected officials, that's all it is. It favors abuses of power, including torture. Its actual value of generating usable intelligence is minimal, often wrong, often misleading, inaccurate, and harmful. Such as the WMDs in Iraq, of which, believe it or not, we did find some. We found sarin canisters, by the way, but it didn't justify what we did. But it does prove that Bush didn't completely lie. Not that he was a good president. The Association for the Responsible Dissent estimates that by 1987, 6 million people had died as a result of the CIA covert operations. Former State Department official William Bloom correctly calls it an American Holocaust. Let's see, the CIA crimes against humanity is to associate each of the interventions with death, injuries, disruptions of lives, and destruction that it has caused. Let's go through some of these, okay? In Afghanistan, Somalia, Yugoslavia, Ecuador, Afghanistan again, Venezuela, Iraq, Haiti, Somalia, Honduras, Libya, Syria, and the Ukraine. The asterisks on that list right there, along with the timeline, is cases that the CIA overthrew the governments there, which was looks to be over half. So, I mean, Trump needs to keep his head down when he's doing this, because we elected him to do these kinds of things. We elected him to put his neck out there for us, but God willing, he'll be very, very brave as he does so. Moving on here, the man who threatened to kill Trump was a close friend of the Clintons. Now this is interesting as we head into the inauguration day, because on the last show we talked extensively about asking the question that Rush asked once, another hat tip, how many people do you know that have been murdered? I know a couple, particularly in the neighborhood that I grew up in. nothing that compares to the number of people that the Clintons have known that have died of murder, that's for sure. So, I mean, could we be looking at something here where not just the CIA, but people inside the Clinton machine could also want to do something to him? Well, I'm not going to slander and say that the Clintons didn't know about it, but I think it would be a stretch to imply that... I'm just going to say it. To imply that the Clintons would be more than happy to see it happen. that is something I believe to be true, and I can say that with all honesty, without slandering anybody. I believe they would love to see it happen. How about this schmo? They might have tapped him, I don't know. I mean, he looks like somebody... Go to screen share a little down. He looked like a patsy that they would quite possibly use. But then again, who looks more like a patsy than Bill? So let's go with it. The man arrested by Miami Beach police Tuesday for allegedly threatening President-elect Donald Trump online is a member of the prominent Northeast family close to Bill and Hillary Clinton. See, it's the family. It's not necessarily him. So they may not have done this one. But I doubt they were shedding tears over it. He once gave $20,000 to the Democratic National Committee, DailyMail.com has learned. Suspect Dominique Popolo Jr., 51, sat near Hillary Clinton when she delivered the eulogy at the funeral of Popolo's mother, Sonia, who died in one of the jets that flew into the World Trade Center on 9/11. Well, I don't think Clinton really cared about anybody that died in 9/11. That might have been more of a photo op. During the eulogy on October the 6th in 01 in Boston, the former presidential candidate referred to Dom Jr.'s latest computer wizardry. The wizard is now being held in a Miami-Dade County jail after using Twitter to threaten the life of the president. Well, when did that happen? I mean, I don't mean the threat. I mean that Twitter would actually go after somebody that's made a death threat against the president. They have a history of sort of turning a blind eye to it, if you will. Usually, what do we hear? Yes, that's about what we hear when we expect any help from Twitter when a death threat's been made to the president. So, this is good. Trump is scheduled to be sworn in Friday, of course, today in December, as Popolo remains incarcerated on a charge of threatening to harm a public servant. He reportedly admitting to posting a video saying, "This is the 16th of January, 2017. I will be at the Review Inauguration, and I will kill President Trump. President-elect Trump today." There he is, of course, in better days in 2000. Man, 17 years have been hard on him, haven't they? Good Lord. Picture A, before. Picture B, after. He looks terrible. If he's computer wizardry, it must have been the black arts. He looks like death warmed over. Lord, he was nabbed after leaving a Washington Avenue Subway sandwich shop. All right, well, there you go, friends. Let me tell you what. Now, maybe it's just because when you get near Clintons, it sort of drains the soul from you, and you end up looking like that. He did this on various social media platforms. He posted as Jesus Christ, 1701. The computer consultant claims to have testified in terror cases as an expert witness in the German Federal Court of Hamburg in 03 and 08. Well, the mighty has definitely fallen here. This stands out. It really does. He looks terrible. There's the Popolo family. According to news archives, his mother, Sonia, was married to a wealthy Nantucket businessman. Now, see, that's the only reason Hillary Clinton cared about it. There was money to be made and a photo op to be had by showing up and acting like she cared. Just the same, while I don't necessarily believe they hired the person, I wouldn't be surprised to learn that they did. And I also don't think they're shedding very many tears over the fact that's probably not happening. End of the American dream, Michael Snyder. America has become a lot less Christian during the presidency of Barack Obama. Now, I want to talk about this because a lot of people are immediately going to go, blah, 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 separation of church and state. Now, it is very important that we keep the government away from endorsing religions, such as we are seeing happen with Saudi Arabia becoming basically a Sharia nation. It oppresses everyone. However, America was founded on the basis of the Christian faith, which means that the tenets of Christianity, even if not Christianity itself, is fully endorsed in the Constitution. And if you don't like it, then change the Constitution or move. Or deal with it. Because there's right and wrong. And when you have moved to take Christianity out of the schools the way that the left has, which you have actually done, and they did this on purpose. It wasn't just that they hated Christianity, which they detest, by the way, but they don't like the precepts of it. So by pulling Christianity and teachings that are the basis for the founding of the country out, not only can you lessen the effect of the Constitution in terms of how important it is, in terms of how it speaks to us being created beings with rights given to us by God Himself, not only do you diminish exactly what that means when you diminish who God is, and God very much is, but also you work very hard to lessen the fabric and moral structure of the country. That way, when people go killing each other in greater numbers than ever, then you can go ahead and lock up more people. And then when you're running for-profit prison scams, then you can make a lot of money by destroying the fabric of the culture and the Christian influence in the culture. And that's what we're seeing here, highlighted very nicely here by Michael Snyder. In 2006, Barack Obama famously said that we are no longer just a Christian nation. And after the last 8 years, has now proved to be more true than ever. The Pew Research Center just released a major report entitled How America Changed During Barack Obama's Presidency. And what struck me the most about the report was the fact that it showed that the United States became a lot less Christian while Obama was in the White House. Of course, this trend did not begin under Obama. It seems to have accelerated during his presidency. It said, in particular, the percentage of Americans that have no religion at all is growing rapidly. And what's interesting about that is that we live in a time now where things, look this stuff up, it's free. The two slits experiment has scientifically proved that we are living in a simulated reality and that we are, in fact, created beings. The fact that we're created beings isn't even up for debate anymore. Science has accepted this. They just don't, of course, call him God, but there's no other name you would be able to come up with. The aliens did it. Let's find who created the aliens. At a time when science has proved that we are created, more people than ever are now believing that we're not. You see how the government and the elite and the powers that be, the people pulling the strings, do you see how they can destroy a culture this way? Feed them lies. Who's the father of lies? The devil. When it comes to the nation's religious identity, the biggest trend during Obama's presidency, it's reported, is the rise of those who claim no religion at all. Those who self-identify as atheists or agnostics, as well as those who say that their religion is nothing in particular, now make up nearly a quarter of the U.S. adult population, up 16% from 2007. I thought it was more than a quarter, but I didn't realize it went up 16% by 2007. Christians, meanwhile, have fallen from 78% to 71% of the adult population, owing mainly to modest declines in the shares of adults who identify with mainland Protestantism or Catholicism. The share of Americans identifying with evangelical Protestantism, historically black Protestant denominations, and other smaller Christian groups, by contrast, have remained fairly stable. Now, see, that does speak a lot, though, to the church itself, because people are starting to distrust the bigger churches, and again getting into the smaller churches that actually teach, the Word of God, not this feel-goodism that says we're all going to be raptured before the tribulation, but the Absurer Bible that says that we're going to go through the tribulation and be miserable, and those of us that believe that we may just in fact be doing so now. But this death of Christianity in America is something that has been openly stated by many groups as an end goal, an end game, if you will. Not the least of which is New World Order elites and what's the name of the group? The United Nations. When these numbers don't just reflect a group of dissatisfaction with organized religion, the truth is that Americans are becoming less spiritual overall. Snyder writes that compared with 07, fewer Americans believe in God, fewer Americans consider religion to be very important in their lives, fewer Americans pray daily, and fewer Americans attend religious services. I'm guilty of the latter. I usually only go to church on Easter, believe it or not. But I do listen to the teachings of Chuck Swindoll and Alistair Begg and some of the people who are grounded, Charles Stanley, who's firmly in the historic Christian faith. If people heard me by myself talking to myself as I pray, I guess it's not talking to myself, but didn't think I was, they'd probably lock me up. We're seeing a nation that gets away from that. And, you know, I can do it myself while they're not doing it themselves. America's falling quickly. Trends are evident in all age groups. The biggest shift is millennials. I'm not in the always blame of the millennials category. Gen Xers like myself have dropped the ball, and we are the ones that raised a godless nation here. According to the report, 11%, and again, you got to remember that the Gen Xers started that with their 60s movement of abandoning the Christian faith. It used to be that families went to church every Sunday. It was unheard of not to, unless they were a Seventh-day Adventist. I remember growing up, my friend Jeff, his family every Sunday. According to the report, 11% of the silent generation are nuns, 17% of the baby boomers are nuns, and 23% of Gen X is nuns. But an astounding 35% of millennials are nuns. As the older generations die off, America is changing, but not for the better. So, you know, what exactly does this mean? Well, it says the implications for this church leadership in America is absolutely staggering. To a very large degree, we are failing to reach an entire generation of Americans, and we are in great danger of being transformed into a post-Christian society. I believe that we are, like so many countries in Europe have become. Well, you say it works just well for Europe, right? Maybe it doesn't. Maybe when you decide that the Christian God is just as good as any God, then you'll allow people that radically worship Allah to come into your nation, like the EU has, overrun it, rape people, grow people, and make it so that you can't even have the carnival or New Year's Eve parties anymore. So maybe all gods aren't even after all. Maybe all religions aren't so even after all. Maybe some really are better than others. Maybe some are based in fact and some aren't. And if you don't think Christianity is, don't take my word for it. Please listen to The Case for Christ. It's free. It's online. Witchcraft is catching up among adults. I found that a lot of adults are kind of like weekend Satanists from the 80s. They would put on a Slayer record and thought they worshipped the devil. Not only are they pathetic looking, but the trouble is that they tend to, they tend to start to believe their own hype, and since nothing happens when they worship the devil, when they were 14, the devil never came out of their pentagram and killed their mother, because she grounded them and took their, you know, whatever, Xbox away, since that didn't happen, then they grow up believing that there is no power in any of this. And it does drive people away from the true and historic Christian faith. But it's this witchcraft thing. For those who are actually in witchcraft, they may have gotten in it because of some TV show or something. I'm not a real big believer on that. I don't believe that Harry Potter causes witches. I believe the bad parenting with Harry Potter causes witches. But whatever. It's their right to do it. I'm not saying that, but I'm saying this. Clearly. We are going to find an ever-growing number of problems with this if we continue to downplay the importance of what it is that the Constitution is based on, which, whether you like it or not, are the precepts of Christianity. You don't have to be a Christian, but you do at least have to realize that that is the basis of the fabric of the country. I have somebody very close to me that was saying she was a witch, and she doesn't know five things about it. It's just something that people think is cool, and it's a lot easier to do than actually reading the Bible, committing yourself to history, and, you know, studying the precepts of the religion. You can kind of get this feel-good fuzziness from witchcraft that makes you feel like you're religious in some way when you actually don't know anything about the damn religion. So that's likely what's causing the rise of witchcraft. And I know a handful of real witches who, while I don't agree with, would certainly agree with me. And these weekend jobbies are a joke. this is brought to you, friends, by The Day the Light Went Out. Lights Went Out by D. Alan Ross. You can find it on Amazon. The Sun. Horror legend passes away. William Peter Blatty, dead aged 89. As tributes pour in for the Exorcist author. Now, he died on Friday the 13th, no less. Many people don't realize that, director, what's William Friedkin? Oh, that's who announced his death. I thought Friedkin died too. That's what you get for reading on air. That's what happens when people look at only one side of something. People remember that William Peter Blatty wrote The Exorcist, which is quite possibly the most terrifying movie, many people say. I think it's scary. I don't think it's that scary, but the implications of it are probably the scariest. Many people know that The Exorcist is based on true stories. Not necessarily the head turning all the way around, although it has been reported that that has happened. It's not reported. I don't believe that anyone was okay afterwards. Maybe. But many, there's actual documented cases for a lot of what is in the movie The Exorcist. The speaking in languages that you don't know, speaking in reverse, a three-year-old knowing 15 languages that are extinct. The swearing, the cussing, the changing of the look, the cutting of the skin that heals immediately after the exorcism. Like, almost immediately after. With not only days, I mean moments. Those are real. And people tend to think about William Peter Blatty in that regard. I don't know that they realize that he wrote quite possibly the funniest movie of all time. Anyone? Come on. Anyone at all? A Shot in the Dark, which of course was a Pink Panther movie and has Peter Sellers in it, and is as funny as The Exorcist is scary. Dear friend and brother who created The Exorcist passed away. There is the tweet. I'm going to go to screen share again for my low-deaf friends. Interesting story here, by the way, friends. I think you'll like it. We got a couple more to get to as well. The writer won the Oscar in 1973, my birth year, for his screenplay based on his book that was published in 71, which told the story of a child possessed by a demon. It was so popular that in 2 years they managed to make that screenplay. That's amazing. Thanks to the film's success, a possessed child's image has become iconic among horror fans. Linda Blair in 73 played the child. The author passed away, but news of his death has only emerged today. His birthday was on January 7th, so he just had a birthday too. Blatty not only wrote the original Exorcist film, but he also directed the third installment of the franchise. You could tell too, because the second one sucked and the third one was also really good. It had the guy that played Billy Bibbit from One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest playing one of the most amazing psychopaths of all time. There he is. Since the news of his death has emerged on social media, tributes have been pouring in. Rest in peace, William Peter Blatty wrote The Peerless Exorcist and the funniest Clouseau film, Shot in the Dark. Yes, there's somebody who mentioned it. Someone who mentioned the first and the third Exorcist, there's Scott Tobias. Shocking jump scare movie he's ever seen. So, he was born in New York. He worked as a door-to-door salesman in the 50s before eventually breaking into writing just before 1960. 10 years, because you live in a dumb country, that's why. You know how much longer it would take you now? Good Lord. Initially, I'm being distracted by Hogan. Initially, he graduated Georgetown University and later got a master's in English Literature at the Washington University. Growing up as a poor household, William was a devout Roman Catholic, and his writings also revolved around Shakespeare and the crisis of faith. He is also known for his work in the horror genre. William actually started his career as a comedy writer, working for director William Blake's. Of course, he led to the funniest movie ever. And he also did Darling Lily, which starred Rock Hudson and Julie Andrews. Julie Andrews, of course, an icon as well. And again, yeah, his films included The Great Bank Robbery, The Man from the Diners Club, I haven't seen that one, and Promise Her Anything. Pity. Real pity. A CIA agent says Malachi Martin. Let's get to that. We got our own story here. He's not the only person tied to The Exorcist here that has passed on. The Catholic priest that inspired The Exorcist died from a fall after a possessed child spoke to him, and he was pushed over by an invisible force, the CIA claims. This is for all of those that think evil does not exist. The Catholic priest who inspired The Exorcist died from a fall after what he claims was a possessed child that spoke to him as he emerged. The new revelation comes from a CIA agent after it had been widely reported that Malachi Martin from Ireland told a friend an invisible force pushed him to his death. Ahead of the release of a new documentary, his close friend Robert Morrow has lifted the lid from the moment he believes the priest was effectively killed when a possessed four-year-old girl that he was meant to be exorcising spoke to him in America. And there he is. There is the priest. Talking to the RTE Radio ones, the Rio Tibridi show, the producer of the feature-length show called Hostage to the Devil, Rachel Lysolts, recalled a harrowing moment during filming. Former CIA agent Mr. Morrow retracted the steps to Connecticut where Father Martin had offered to carry out an exorcism for the four-year-old girl. When he arrived at the neutral home, the family were already there, and the girl walked up to the priest and said, "So you're Malachi Martin, and you think you can help her," suggesting she was talking while having an out-of-body experience. It was then claimed that after the exchange in 1999, a fall led to his death from a head trauma at the age of 78. So it took a while to kill him, kind of like Brady was found to have killed. Brady was found to have been killed by Reagan's shooter years after, because the injuries from the shooting are what caused the death years later, is how that works. He told a friend that it was caused by an invisible force that pushed him. By this time, the father from County Kerry in southwestern Ireland was hiring himself out as a private exorcist. It is believed that he was the inspiration behind the famous film released in 1973. Due to the father Martin's age, Mr. Morrow drove him to his clients across America, where he had relocated after turning his back on the church. The former CIA agent told RTE the encounter between the priest and the girl was the most disturbing thing he had ever seen, according to Rachel Lysart, who also wrote the new documentary. So, check this out, friends. Do yourselves a favor and really listen to this. The pastor does not have a history of being a liar here. The CIA agent, despite the fact that he does work for the CIA, so we should question that at least, doesn't have a history that we know of any kind of lying or dishonesty here. And we just talked about how, we just did a whole section on how evil is supposed to exist in the world, right? Because good and evil don't exist. They're things for another generation, right? Well, now you've got some food for thought there, and we also have the dumbdee of the day. There it is, friends. Let me give you some volume so we can hear our beautiful theme song. The You Are an Idiot theme song. Who's getting it today? Well, how many of you have realized how dishonest the student loan racket really is? For instance, I'll give you a story that it's from me here, someone who's living through it. I took out a number of student loans, and my wife at the time, my ex-wife, took out a number of student loans that I did not know about in my name, and I found out about it after we departed. While we were breaking up, I moved, and student loans did not have my change of address for reasons that I do not know. And only, they couldn't find me to send me a bill. Oh, but they could find me quick enough when it came time to default me. They promised you low rates when you take out your student loans, and yet, when you go to pay them back, those rates go through the roof if you have any trouble making those payments. And they go up to levels that would be loan sharking. Okay, I have a degree in IMT of which I'll probably never be able to pay for. It was so bad. They lie to you about the rates and then destroy your credit for the rest of your life after they have lied about it. And this is somehow legal. Well, the U.S. government, who's getting the dumbdee of the day, has been caught massively fabricating student loan default data. This is from Zero Hedge. Ever since in 2012, we have warned that one of the biggest threats arising in the U.S. is the student loan bubble, which is no longer disputed by anyone except perhaps members of the outgoing administration. It is not that it is soaring at an unprecedented pace. That's obvious for anyone who has the latest student loan total of over $1.4 trillion, rising at a pace of $100 billion per year. But the government, either on purpose or due to honest miscalculation, was not correctly accounting for the true extent of the delinquencies and defaults. Today, we got confirmation that, as speculated, the U.S. government was indeed fabricating student loan default data, making it appear that far fewer than what is in reality. Now, there are things that the government does, too, and that the system does, that make this a particularly nightmarish problem. One of the things that they do is by forcing students to take classes that they know that the student is going to fail before they make them take it. They then lie and say that it's for a well-rounded education. What do I mean? I mean taking journalist majors and forcing them to take trigonometry. They know that there's a likelihood that such a student is going to fail or drop, and they're going to have to take out more student loan money in order to take it, just to get their degree. When the government is deliberately making them sign up for classes that they have no aptitude for, and it happens all the time. You've got people being forced to take women's studies and things like that. Forcing people to take classes to get a degree that have absolutely nothing to do with the blossoming of society in any way, shape, manner, or form. The Wall Street Journal reported overnight many more students have defaulted or failed to pay back their student loans than the government had previously believed, or admitted is a better word. The admission, came last Friday when the Education Department released a memo saying that it had overstated student loan repayment rates and at most colleges and trade schools and provided updated numbers. It also means that the number of student loan defaults in various cohorts is far greater than previously revealed. What, the government lies? How could it be? It was the infamous glitch. The technical glitch has struck again. It says, how bad was the fabrication? Well, when the Wall Street Journal analyzed the new numbers, seen right there, the data revealed that the department previously had inflated the repayment rates by 99.8% of all colleges and trade schools in the country. In other words, virtually every single number was made to appear better than it actually was, and people mocked China for its own fake data. According to the analysis of the data revised at more than 1,000 colleges and trade schools, or about a quarter of the total, at least half of the students had defaulted or failed to pay back at least $1 on their debt within 7 years. $1? Who gives a damn? This is a stunning number that suggests that the student loan crisis is far greater than anyone had anticipated previously. It also means that the U.S. taxpayer will be on the hook for hundreds of billions in government-funded loans. Well, when you have schools that are lying about, when the government lies to you about what rate it's going to give you, or it allows others to do so, that could be a problem. That could be a rather significant problem. When the government is giving loans to people, hoping that some future job is going to appear for them to pay it back, maybe it would be wise. Here's an idea. Just a random idea. This would help solve the college problems. We don't currently charge income tax to students under, or to people under the age of 18 years or older. Okay. What if we took... If we're going to stay in the business of student loans, let me say up front, being a libertarian, I think the government needs to not give student loans, and it needs to be done by the state, because the Constitution says that the things that are not outlined in the Constitution are, in fact, matters of the state. So, let me say that first. If we're going to continue on the path that we are on, then why don't we take those that are under the age of 18 who can legally work, and say that we are taking out a certain amount of money from your paycheck that will be good until you are 25 years old. You will be able to go to college or a trade school or a vocational school because you paid into this when you worked as a minor. How much money you get depends on how much you made, that wouldn't be fair to the people working, but to pay based on how much you worked. They have limits on how much you can work a kid so you don't flunk him out of school. That's a good idea. If the government must be involved in schooling, that's a good idea. But we could see some major changes here. And then when the kid turned 25, if he didn't go to college, then I think he should get all the money back that he put in. That's one idea. There are a number of ideas that could be used here to further the cause, getting rid of... Why don't you quit giving a journalist college algebra, for instance? That might be a good idea. As the WSJ adds, and this isn't the first time data problems have affected the education department. Yeah, they've lied about this forever. But the point is, the dumbdee of the day is very much going to the government for lying about student loans because they have started something that many people have said for a long time we already knew was going to lead in a direction that was just like this. Okay, I got student loans, I'll probably never be able to pay them off. They lie to you about the rates, and they force you to take a myriad of classes that you don't need. And thirdly, I'll be 44 in a few days. If you want to send me a gift, January 25th, the correct views of hotmail.com, PayPal, thank you. All jokes aside, I've been working since I was 16. So, I could have gone a long way to pay for my college from the ages of 16 to 18. Could have kept the money and paid for it myself. I did. But the government claims that if they take your money, they can do so much more with it than you can, right? Now, if a little bell just went off in your head and said, well, wait a minute. The kid could keep more of his own money without the government taking it. Yes, he could. If he wasn't paying for everything else that a lot of kids do have to pay for. So, let's reevaluate whether or not we need to be handing out money from the federal government for college. And let's talk about whether or not if the government is going to do that and not the state. Again, I do think it's important to have money coming in the form of grants and loans. Not all of them are from the government. But the government is sinking itself with this. And there's a reason that student loan companies are doing well. And the government in the business of student loans is doing very poorly. And if that makes sense to you, make sure that you let me know. Please donate to my show if you could at thecorrectviews@hotmail.com. I see viewers down there. I see a bunch of you. Help me. All the money you give to me, I put in towards a better show. And you can make that better show happen by any money you give me. I hold receipts up to the camera and tell people what it was used for. Money you give to me goes towards a better show. So thecorrectviews@hotmail.com. would go a long way to help me. Look me up on the Conservative Daily Post. Hit share, hit subscribe. Look me up on Blasting News. Look up the band Passing Time, and until next time, God bless you and thank you for your time.